Good morning, my loves. Adele Clough with you here. This is the Get Inspired Show, airing on Smile Radio. I am a life coach, inspiring everyone to live their happiest, most fulfilling life. I'm not going to deny it. I'm a little under the weather. You might be able to hear it in my voice. It sounds almost as though I want to audition for a bit of a late night love show. I don't. I'm simply being a cheeky non-conformist and I've got flu in the springtime. So today's show is sponsored by a generic brand of throat sweets. I won't say the brand name because they've not paid for advertising. So please, please bear with me if I get a little bit croaky. I am really excited about today's show. I've been wanting to do it for quite a while, actually. It's all about reshaping our past. And it's fascinating, really, to look at why some people who've had really difficult past experiences seem to move on and live a happy life, and others seem to get stuck and their identity gets really wrapped up in an event or a set of circumstances. So we're going to really unpick that a little bit today, and I think it will be really fascinating whether or not you yourself identify as having troubled times and things that have set you back. One of the things I really like to look at is people's human behaviour, why we do what we do, why people struggle, why people suffer, and why others excel and live wonderful lives. So the format of today's show will be quite loose. I'll be running through some ways of thinking, different ways of thinking, offering you some opportunities to understand your own past and how we create stories about our past and how they shape our current experiences. I'll also be setting you some exercises you might like to try. I'll be inviting you to try out a few little things while songs are playing. We might have a few more songs this time than last time because I need to get on those throat sweets so I don't get too croaky. Before we dive in, I'm just going to share with you a little humorous story of the last radio station I was at. And I actually had what they called Australian flu. It sounds very exotic, doesn't it? But let me tell you, there was no spontaneous kind of ripped men and barbecues popping up around my sick bed. It was just a really severe form of flu. And it actually started really when I was live on air doing a Sunday morning show. And for the first time ever, I used the magical button that is rather like when a plane's coming in to land and they use an autopilot. The radio equipment we were using had an option called auto assist. And I'd never used it. But when I was in training to go on air, they said there's this auto assist button and it sort of does your automatic timings for you. Because strangely, when you're listening to radio, you don't realise that there's a fair bit of maths involved in terms of timing yourself to different things that might happen on certain stations. So I was in the last 20 minutes of my show. I needed to time it to the second to go to Sky News, a Sky News broadcast. And I was sort of very feverish and felt as though I was losing a bit of touch with reality. So I pressed the magic auto assist button and basically lost complete control of my show. I didn't realise that it would mean I would no longer be able to turn my microphone up and speak. And I was pressing buttons, skipping through commercials, panicking, knowing I had to get the commercials back because people had paid for them. And I did, unfortunately, the next presenter came in and I was like, what am I doing? And needed a little bit of help to get my show back under control. So this morning when I was getting ready to do the show, feeling those familiar feelings of feverishness, I was reminded of that. So there will be no auto assist on today's show. I will be keeping control. And even though I am feeling slightly, should we say I'm feeling summery because I'm wearing a vest and behaving as though the weather's very hot when in fact it's just me that's hot. Everyone else is fairly cool around me. So there's a funny little story about what happens in live radio and that things are not always as they seem. I just wanted to share that with you because this morning it really helped me to think about a time I'd got through a challenge that was a similar challenge and that everything was okay. and just to reconnect with being excited to be on air and be with you. So thank you so much for tuning in. If this is your first time listening to a show, I am a life coach. I support people to look at how they would like life to be, set goals. I help them to look at what is blocking them from living their happiest, most fulfilling life. And I help them create the life they want to live. So if you're interested in that, you can head over to my website, adeleclough.com. If you want to look at what I do on social media, I am working hard to be more active on social media. You will find me at Adele Clough Coaching, except for on Twitter, because there's that pesky 15 character limit. So on Twitter, I'm Adele Clough Co. Adele Clough CO. So do connect with me. So without further ado, I think we should have a little song and then we should dive in. Now, while the song's playing, I invite you to just grab yourself a notebook, a pen, an electronic device, whatever you would like, so that you can take some notes and, you know, use this throughout the coming days and weeks, because it is invaluable. Remember, this is what I go through with my clients. So you're getting some wonderful freebie life coaching right here. So please do make the most of it. This first song I've chosen is called Let's Live for Today. It was originally by The Grassroots, but this is a cover by The Atomics and I really love it.
Their minds chasing after money and dreams that can't come true. I'm glad that we are different, we've better things to do. Let others plan the future, I'm busy loving you.
Atomics, Let's Live for Today, playing on Smile Radio. This is the slightly croaky Adele Clough. I'm a life coach inspiring everyone to live their happiest, most fulfilling life. And today's show is a really exciting one. Do not let my croakiness put you off from the power of today's show, we are talking all about reshaping your past and how some people who've had really difficult experiences move on past that and are living happy, fulfilling lives, and others are held back and trapped in a very much of a victim pattern and living out the life of a victim. So whatever your current circumstance, it's going to be really interesting for you to just think about people that what I'm talking about applies to, who it reminds you of, but also hopefully it will be applicable in your own life as well and be really useful to you. So when I work with my clients on their past and looking at the past, I invite them to focus on the past being perfect. Now this can be really challenging to think about because of course in people's past can be a whole array of experiences and some of them might well be horrific. I myself had a very challenging childhood that featured various types of abuse. So it's taken me quite a lot of time to be confident to speak publicly and to certainly to speak on radio about inviting people to focus on their past as being perfect. And I feel as though I needed to share with you that my childhood was in some ways traumatic in order to almost validate my choice to speak about it, to prove to you that I have a right to say that almost. It feels important to share that my childhood did feature abuse because that may well help anyone that's listening to this thinking, but how can I think my past was perfect? I was abused, I was mistreated. I still say to you, I invite you to focus on your past as being perfect. I have experienced a lot of trauma, but I feel that that was just how it was meant to happen. It was what it was, and it grew me to be a strong, resilient, empowered woman who speaks live on air, who does her own radio show that she writes and presents and produces. And I do that, I believe, because of some of the trauma I went through and because of my passion to speak out and to share with people how we can change our lives. And to my core message in so much of what I speak about is our past does not define us in the here and now. Your circumstances and past do not define who you are. You get to create whoever you want to be and you get to create whatever you want. Now, I think this is what we should be taught in schools. I've got a 6-year-old boy, he's just 6, and his teacher is obsessed with finger spaces. And if I'm obsessed with anything, I'm obsessed with him recognising feelings and emotions and experiencing play, experiencing joy. But also, when he's upset and frustrated, I'm obsessed with him knowing that we're choosing our experiences, we're choosing what to think, and that our thoughts will create a different feeling. The reason I'm saying about school is I would love it if we were taught in school so much more about how our brain works and how we have power over our own lives. For me, that's the most important lesson we could possibly learn. Finger spaces are not on the top of my list for teaching my 6-year-old. I do expect as he gets older, he'll be able to write and use finger spaces, but at 6, does it matter? It doesn't matter. I'm just letting that roll, really, because he is at school and I've chosen to send him to school rather than home educating. So it was my choice to expose him to the national curriculum and all that that brings with it. So that leaves me teaching people about what I believe is really important, people of all ages, including, obviously, young children. But my work is primarily with adults, and that invitation to focus on their past being perfect. And some of my clients will embrace this and be like, tell me more about it. What do you mean? And how do I get to that place? And yes, I want to see it that way. And others are resistant and experience a broad range of feelings from frustration to disappointment in me to maybe anger to questioning, coaching, and what's the point in it. And it's for some people, it's as though letting go of holding their story as it currently is, letting go of a story about them that featured abuse and suffering. If they let that story go, then I mean, some people feel that then they're lying to themselves or that they're losing a part of their identity. Now, that's really interesting, isn't it? The idea of losing identity around being a victim. Let's think about that. So if we, our story, the way we tell it, let me just explain what I mean. If someone says, oh, tell me about your past troubled relationship or tell me about your difficult childhood, how we tell that story has got multiple possibilities, from strength and courage to being a weak victim to a narrative of it's not fair. If we're really connected with the story as a victim, how hard it was, life's not fair, some people have it better than me, if that's how we live our day-to-day life from that place, then what we will tune into is lots of difficulty and negativity and hardship. And it's our thoughts about what's happening in our world, in our life, that creates that difficulty, that challenge. So let me give you a concrete example. When you are going somewhere by car, if you're fortunate enough to have a vehicle, you're in the car, you go in and you get a flat tire and you're on your way to a commitment. You have a choice what you think about that. So you can think, oh gosh, it could only happen to me. Just my luck. This is how life always is for me. Nothing ever goes right. And you can just feel horrific and set the tone for the rest of the day and carry that with you, and that will shape whatever happens next. Or you can think, oh goodness, this is a setback. Let's think what I can do to remedy the situation. And you can have some choices about what you do. You can make a call to wherever you're going and your commitment and explain. You've got a flat tire and what your course of action will be. It might be to jump on the bus. It might be to use a taxi. It might be to change your tire and continue your journey. It might be to call breakdown cover out if you have it. It might be to ask a passerby to help. So there's lots of choices. But ultimately, a flat tire is not, it's not a life-threatening situation, is it? It's a flat tire. And actually what makes it upsetting and distressing are simply the thoughts we have about the flat tire. Not being fair, always happens to me, what will they think of me? I've ruined my situation that I was going to, nothing good can come of it. And actually none of that's true. They're just stories we're telling, that it's just a narrative we're creating. Now let's imagine you're going to a job interview, which is something you want to arrive punctually for, and you want to look your best and present your best. I think if I was interviewing somebody, which I have done in the past, I've interviewed people, if I received a call from someone saying, good morning, my name is such and such, I have an interview at 10:15 this morning. Now, I am at this point on my journey and I've got a flat tire. So my plan is, I just need to get my vehicle to a safe place close by and I'll be jumping in a taxi to get to you. I don't want to change the tire and arrive looking a mess, so I'd like to apologise in advance if I arrive a little late. That's fine. That's somebody organised, calm, capable, responsible, forward thinking, wonderful attributes for whatever the job you're applying for is. So can you see how it isn't the flat tire that's the issue? It's simply the thoughts. And you know, if you listen to my show, you know that I talk so much about thoughts create feelings. Feelings create the life we live in, our perception of life. We've got to watch those thoughts, haven't we? And when we think about the current pain we experience from a past event, I say to you, there is no current pain about something that happened 20 years ago. There is no current pain. Your parents may have abused you 20 years ago, but the only thing that is currently hurting you right now in 2019 are your thoughts about the abuse. And again, this is really challenging. And so many people want to say, that is not fair to say, Adele, you cannot say that. But I can say that. I can say that. I do understand how the brain works. And this is true. The pain people currently experience from an event that is in the past is largely based on their thoughts about it. Now, of course, there's conditions like post-traumatic stress disorder. Please, if you have that, or suspect you have it, by all means, please work with a therapist. Seek support. Seek the support you need to begin recovery. But typically, if we don't have a condition like that, we are walking through life carrying our past experiences, carrying it as a current pain. And I'm inviting you to put it down. Put it down now. What do you want to think and feel about your past? Because I promise you, the only pain you are currently experiencing is caused by your thoughts and not the event itself. Your pain is caused by the current story you are telling yourself about the event or the experience or the experiences. So let me give you evidence that what I'm saying is true. I'm going to invite you to think about, what do you want to think and feel about this past event? There you go. There's the open question, the choice. What do you want to think and feel about this past event? And you get 100% control about this. You get to decide how the story is, what the story is of the past event. You get to shape it so that you come out as a strong person, a courageous person. And you get to believe it happened and that was how it was meant to be. Not because you're a victim, not because you're always unlucky, but it was simply a part of your life story. It was one part. My hope is that it was a small part. So let me give an example of what I mean by a small part. I'm 42 years old and I had a really difficult time for the first 16 years of my life. As I said, my childhood featured multiple types of abuse, and I will share that the police were involved in my safety as a teenager. And I'll also share that I'm very, very fortunate to still be alive. So that gives you a little essence, really, of what we're talking about. So that was 16 years of my life. Now, that's not even half of my life, is it? I realised when I was 32, oh, wow, I've had the same amount of years of great things and been in control of my life and living a wonderful life. So it's a small part of my life, just as a mathematical percentage. A small part of my life was marred with abuse. My choice is that that doesn't shape who I am today. Well, maybe it does shape it, because I say that it's led to me being a resilient, strong, courageous woman. But what I mean is it doesn't define me. My past circumstances do not define who I am. They are a part of the story. And for sure, there was a big new chapter that happened when I was 16 and I began to live independently as a 16-year-old and started to shape my life how I wanted it to be. And I think there's real power as well in seeing like the percentage of your life. So if you have a horrible relationship for 3 years or 5 years, but you're in your 30s, again, it's a small percentage of your life. What else has gone on? Keep it in its place. I think it's time for a song. I think I need a throat sweet. This is some heavy stuff. I wonder what feelings you're having. Let them come. Let them come. But again, just remember, the reason I share this with you is that this is where the power lies in shaping your life. Going through this tough stuff of, oh my goodness, I actually have a choice in how I see things. I'm not just a victim, and that's a label stuck on me that I cannot remove. It can be scary. It can bring things up around, who am I if I'm not that person? Who do I want to be? I don't know. This can be quite groundbreaking to think about. So please be gentle with yourself. And if you're noticing some feelings of being wobbly or upset, just, you know, that's okay. This is big stuff. And you know, it's not your fault. If you'd been taught this at school, then it would be much easier. So know that it's okay to feel really wobbled, but that the purpose is that in time you can use this. You can use this to shape the life you want to have, to release painful stuff, things that we perceive as painful right now, things that keep cropping up and affecting us and bringing with them a wave of unpleasant feeling and emotion. So my question again, while we play a song, is, what do you want to think and feel about your past event? Have a think about that. What would you like to think and feel? It doesn't have to feel real at the moment as you write it down. I'd love you to write it down. It's just creating a story. Imagine it's just a work of fiction. So just begin. I'll put a song on in a moment, but I want you to begin writing. When I think about my past, here is what I want to think and feel. Or you could start with, when I think about the relationship with whoever, here's what I want to think and feel about it. When I think about my mum abusing me, here's what I want to think and feel about that. So while you're doing that, I'm going to play you some Nora Jones. This is Carry On.
Just forget, leave it behind and carry on. If you should find the time to speak, then speak to me. I'd never keep you from your final destiny. So carry on. I lost my nerve, yet peace surrounds, so carry on.
Carry On. You're listening to Smile Radio. This is the Get Inspired show with me, Adele Clough. I am a life coach inspiring everyone to live their happiest, most fulfilling life. And today I'm a little croaky. I am a cheeky nonconformist. I have flu in the spring. So I'm so sorry if I don't sound my usual sprightly self. Nonetheless, it is an absolutely wonderful show today. We are talking all about reshaping your past and why some people who've had very difficult life events come out of it stronger, move on, seem to live happy, fulfilling lives, and others get trapped in more of a victim state. So it's really interesting, just as a kind of looking at the human experience, but it's also really interesting if you yourself have gone through something that has felt like a setback. Just before I played Nora Jones, I asked you to think, to make a note of what you would like to think and feel about a past event and just kind of note that down, you know. So my invitation was that you would write something like, in regard to the relationship I had that lasted 3 years, what I would like to think and feel about it is, or similar. I wonder how that was for you. I'm thinking some of you will have run with it and got into writing it as a piece of fiction, knowing it's okay that it doesn't feel natural, it doesn't seem real, that's fine. For others of you, you would be like, maybe I can't do that. That's just too hard. I can't figure out how to write that. And my question for you is, what is in it for you to not figure it out? What do you get from not figuring it out? There's always a positive when we can't do something or we feel we can't do it. What do you get from keeping the story as it is, the way you currently experience and re-experience the event? And this, the question of why haven't you figured it out? What is stopping you from figuring it out? What is in it for you to not figure it out? That is so powerful. I use this for myself a lot. Why aren't I figuring it out? What's in it to stay stuck? It can be scary to live life differently. It can be scary to make changes, to step away from our comfort zone. We are very much creatures of habit. Humans love habit. And you can see that by how so often children grow up to duplicate a similar lifestyle to their parents. Their comfort zone is very much around the type of life they had as a child. Not always, certainly for me, mine is radically different to those in my family. But often the norm is that our parents or our caregivers set out how life will be, how life will look, what expectations we will have. And then I come along and mess that up and say, whoa, you can change your life. You can have a life that's just how you want it to be. And then we come up against the reality of that when I start asking difficult questions, really. But we, you know, I've put it out there. That's my invitation for you to try and emphasize. And we're going to carry on. So if you need to take more time on that, this show will go up on Mixcloud. You'll find me there, mixcloud.com/ Adele Clough Coaching. You can listen to it back, but stay with us because the rest of it is interesting for you to use whenever you're ready. I want you to just have some time to notice that there's a difference between facts and feelings. So there's the facts of an event. That's the part where there's a chronological timeline of things that are specific that happened, that can be described, and that can be described as though they are being written in a newspaper. Chronological matter of fact, things that happened, things that are likely evidenceable. I was at this place at this time with this person. Things that definitely happened. Then we bring in emotions, don't we? And thoughts about those facts, those events. And that's where things start to get a little unraveled, and that's where pain starts to come in. I was explaining that we don't have any real pain from an event that is in our significant past, unless it was a recent event. The pain is all about the thoughts we have about the event, the thoughts we think again and again and again, the beliefs we hold about an event. But remember, a belief is simply a thought that you think over and over again. That's what a belief is. It's not a concrete thing. It's something you just create through repetitive thinking. So you can start to think different thoughts and your belief will change, because it cannot stay the same once the different thoughts begin. So that's what we're doing today. We're choosing what we want to believe, we're accepting it as true, and then we're practicing and repeating again and again the different way of thinking, the different belief. And we are committing to let go of the old way of thinking, to release it, to acknowledge it is not serving us well in the here and now, and to peacefully let it go. Now, be gentle with yourself. We are all doing the best with what we have at any one time. So to then realise at a later date, oh my goodness, if I start to think differently, then I experience the whole event differently. Why didn't I know this? Again, you didn't know it because you weren't taught it at school. People who get into personal development, who get into coaching, they begin to learn this. These are the most important life lessons you can possibly learn, I would argue, or at least some of the most, along with things like how to budget and be responsible with money, how to look at what's presented to us as real, such as the news and negativity. And actually, that's a really good example to talk a little bit about in terms of how we shape our life. When I do questionnaires on some courses that I teach, and I ask people what's true and what's false, one of the questions is, the world is a dangerous place. True or false? Now, nearly everyone will say, yes, it is. That is a true statement. The world is a dangerous place. And then we look at, how is that factual? Where are the facts for that? Where is the evidence? Taking away all the emotion and just looking at it calmly in a measured way. How do we know the world is a dangerous place? And the evidence that people give me is, I watch the news, I hear it on the news. My best friend had this thing happen to her, etc., etc. And then I challenge that and say, sir, the world is a dangerous place because you watch and listen to the news. If you don't watch and listen to the news, is the world a safe place? You know, I don't watch or listen to the news, and I don't think the world is a dangerous place. Is that a coincidence? What is that? I personally don't think the world is a dangerous place myself. I think it's a loving place of abundance and joy and kindness and the most amazing people who are just filled with the capacity to give and be loving. And that's because that's how I choose to shape my world and what I choose to focus on. My concern is if people are watching the news and you hear one story, it is multiply reported again and again and again and again, and our brain starts to think, oh my goodness, this is so dangerous, the world is a dangerous place. And let me just bring an example of that a little closer to home for me. There was a devastating experience that happened in my community locally, and I didn't read about it in the news or hear about it, but one of the groups I go to were talking about it. The most beautiful young woman had disappeared and was a missing person, and then her body was found. And it is obviously just so devastating for anyone impacted by it. And what has now happened is that everyone feels frightened because it is not safe near where I live. The reality is, it is the most devastating thing that could happen. And, you know, obviously I wrote in the condolences book and sent my love and best wishes to her family, and have spent some time thinking about her and hoping that wherever she's gone on to, she's at peace. And my hope is that she didn't suffer. Having said that, though, this is the first time this has happened since I've certainly lived in this area, which is 7 years. So if you think about how many days there are in 7 years, if my maths is correct, that's 2,555 days. Now, on one of those days, a young woman was taken and something horrible happened on one of those days. But on 2,554 days, that didn't happen. So statistically, I feel that my area is safe. I can do that because I'm not completely immersed in a missing persons case and then the horrific news of a body being found. I'm not invested deeply in that. I am invested in my community, in seeing if there's anything I can do, seeing what memorials are planned and if there's any way I can support that. Of course, I'm very keen to do that. But what I'm not keen to do is to say, oh my goodness, this has happened, this is terrible. I will wake up and every morning I will check and I will want to know what's happened. Has an arrest been made? Has this happened? Has that happened? Now, if I was personally affected by it, maybe I would be more inclined to do that, and it would be completely reasonable for me to enter into a state of feeling unsafe and fearful, etc. But the point I'm making is, we need to protect our mind from what we're putting in it. And we need to stop this passive taking on of information. And we need to deal with the fact that our bodies will create in us a fight or flight response when we perceive something as danger. So when something happens in a relationship, we will then seek to not go into the same experience again. But what would be sad about us saying we'll never have a relationship again is we close the door on all the good stuff, all the wonderful times we could have with a loving partner because of a previous bad experience. And it's rather like being bitten by a dog and then being completely fearful of all dogs. But the reality is, one dog bit you. All the other dogs that are happily walking along on their leashes, with a little spring in the step, sniffing out all the things that are fun for dogs to sniff, they're just going about their day and they don't pose a threat to you. It was one dog. Keep the blame where it lies. Just focus on, you know, almost that mathematical. It was this much of my life. It was one person. And think about the facts of what happened. So one of the things I tell myself about my past is the facts are my mum found it incredibly difficult in the 1970s to be a single parent because society wasn't set up for that. From a historical standpoint, single parenting in the 70s was very different to single parenting now, where it is more accepted, there's some benefits available, etc. My mum was in a very difficult place with her mental health. That is a fact. That is evidenceable by medication use, etc. I do not feel angry or cross that my mother was unable to care for me. I noticed that we had a system that was lacking in the 70s for supporting women. And we had a limited understanding of mental health compared to now. We still have a limited understanding of mental health, but we're coming on. So when I stick to the facts of my story, I'm able to feel great gratitude that my mother gave birth to me. And, you know, she is a superhero in my eyes. As a single woman in the 70s, going through a birth without her husband there, I know will have been absolutely terrifying. I've given birth. My husband was there. It's a very intense experience. I'm able to apply my knowledge of the experience of birthing and recognise that for my mother, it will have been very difficult. This is not me describing it in an emotional way. It's a very matter-of-fact way, and it's very helpful to me when I've been thinking about how I rewrite my own story to tell it in that way. Here's some of the facts about the time, the 70s, single parenting, available medication for mental health, limited benefits. It does allow me to have some empathy for my mother, but also to hold her as someone who is a superhero in my mind, rather than someone who was complicit in abuse. So although that my story there wasn't completely factual, it did bring in a little bit of empathy. I'm hoping you can see a bit of how that's more helpful than the focus being on, well, this happened to me and that happened to me and I didn't get enough of this and enough of that and that was horrible and that was harrowing and blah, 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 because our thoughts run away with us as soon as we get stuck in our feelings, don't they? If you can just allow the feelings to dissipate and just see some facts, it can be very, very freeing. So I'd like you to make a note of my invitation for you to jot down what the facts of the event or what the facts of the experience were. Not the emotions, just the facts. And within this, I'm inviting you to stop wishing that things didn't happen the way they did. Because that wishing they didn't happen, that feeling of, oh, I'd be different, I wouldn't be struggling now if that hadn't happened, that's causing you suffering. It's causing you unnecessary suffering. So release that desire to rewrite the past. And that comes back to what I was saying at the very beginning of all of this. I was saying that I invite my clients to focus on the past as being perfect, as what happened was meant to happen. That's a way of stopping wishing things didn't happen the way that they did. And that can be really challenging. It can be so difficult to let go of that fantasy, if only things had been different, I'd be like this, I'd be like that. But please, please let it go. You can be like however you want to be, irrespective of what has happened. So there's an opportunity for you to do some work around what is the current story I'm telling myself about this event? What is the story? If you needed to talk about it, what would that story be? And then the next step is, what is the story I want to make this event to mean? What is the story I want to make this event mean? What do you want it to mean? What is the point of the story? What is the theme of the story? because you can now write a new story and you can make yourself the hero, the heroine, the survivor, the superhero, the person that came through it with lessons, with a deeper understanding about the world and life and a desire to shape things to be different. Maybe you could write the story that you came through and you want to help others who have gone through similar experiences. You want to speak out and you want to help others to avoid this experience if it could be avoidable. Or maybe you want to support others who are working through their healing journey. So I'm going to put another song on now. And I'm going to change the pace a little bit because we're moving into that positivity, that new story and all the abundance and great things that can come when we create a new story. So please, during this song, start to think about what is the story I want to make? What do I want to make this event mean? What is the new story? And while you're doing that, here is Grooves in the Heart by Delight. Groove is in the Heart by Delight, playing on Smile Radio. This is the Get Inspired Show with me, Adele Clough. I'm a life coach and I'm inspiring everyone to live their happiest, most fulfilling life. I'm a little bit croaky. I do have a bit of flu, but we are having such an amazing, powerful show today. We're talking about reshaping our past, and we're very close to the end, and there's just a couple more things that I want to say, but let me give you a very quick recap and an overview of what we've covered. I was speaking about when I'm working with people around their past with my clients, I ask them and I invite them to focus on their past as being perfect. And really, I'm inviting them to stop wishing that things didn't happen the way they did. So those things we label as difficult, negative, challenging experiences that shaped us, that made us different as we moved on from them, I invite people to view them in another way and to really find a way to release the power they have over us. And I was saying that there is no current pain from something that happened maybe 20 years ago. But actually the pain we have, what is hurting us now in 2019, is what we think about that experience 20 years ago. Maybe the anger we feel towards someone, how unjust we feel it was, how unfair, unreasonable, how horrible it was. Those words, those feelings, we bring them into our consciousness, or they are triggered into our consciousness, into our current life, and then those feelings are there. Oh, it wasn't fair, it was unjust, he was this, she was that. And then it's back with us and it's shaping who we are now, and it's re-establishing its hold over us. And that is optional. That is an optional thing. If we create different thoughts, then we will have different feelings. If you're joining us late on in the show, please do go and listen back to it. You can head over to Mixcloud, which is mixcloud.com, and you'll find me there, Adele Clough Coaching. The show will be there to hear back in its entirety. If you're catching it at this point, it's probably rather confusing. mixcloud.com/Adele Clough Coaching to hear back the rest of the show. Let's just begin to wrap this up though, this topic, because we've only come so far really with the type of journey a client might go on. And remember, if you're having coaching with me, there's a lot of support, encouragement built into a coaching journey. I'm just really giving you some of it to try yourself. But if you'd like to experience coaching with me, please do send me an email, hello@adeleclough.com. I would absolutely love to support you on your journey of change. It is always a privilege. Please do reach out. So the last thing you were doing was you were thinking about the new story. What is the story you want to make an event mean, the event, the experience mean? What is the new story? How are you going to tell the story and keep thinking it from now on? There's a few more elements though as well that are really important. What do you want to keep from the event that was really strengthening, that was powerful? Because I'm not asking you to wipe out an event from your life. I'm asking you to rewrite it and reformat it and think of it in another way. But it's so important that you hold on to anything that is strengthening to you, that is powerful. Anything you came through, any adversity or hardship, please hold that, because it is a really important part of your life story. Getting through adversity is tough. Please don't try and delete that or wipe that out. Give yourself a moment to say well done. And the other thing is, I would say celebrate it. My goodness, if you happen to have any champagne lingering around from years gone by, get it out of the cupboard and celebrate what you have come through, the triumph of getting through adversity. And if you haven't got any champagne, then grab a packet of party poppers next time you are at the pound shop or the Dollar Tree, or wherever, whatever it's called where you live. Please have a small celebration with party poppers and those things that go in your mouth that go, they're such good fun. Have a mini party to celebrate it. Feel free to involve others or do it yourself. And I am not being sarcastic in this. I really mean it. Please, please, please allow yourself to feel celebratory about what you have come through. Now, the flip side and the part we're going to end on is, what can you let go of? In all of this, what are you letting go of? And obviously some of what you're letting go of is maybe anger, resentment, feeling like life is not fair. Life is what it is. What has happened has gone. We cannot undo it, but there will always be ups and downs. And now you're learning some lessons. You're listening to my show. You're learning some lessons in how to shape life. You can feel positive and hopeful that moving forward, things will be great. Things will be good. You can notice the good things and you can really start to move away from focusing on things that are negative, that do not serve you well. When the news comes on, switch it off, please. Switch it off. Ask people in your life to share with you pertinent things, people you trust, not the negative people who are constantly focused on negative. People will let you know if something that relates to you is happening. So please release negativity. I do hope you found today's show useful. Please do listen back to it on Mixcloud by finding me, Adele Clough Coaching. Find me on social media using that handle as well. Apart from on Twitter, it's Adele Clough Co. I am committing to try more and post more on social media. So hopefully I'll see you on your chosen platform. If this is a special time of year for you, I'm wishing you a joy-filled Easter or Passover. Take care and tune in next time.
Happiness.
Run fast!